love the database. The database which is sitting at the back end. How many of you have loved that? None of you, right? I'm a DB and I have always faced those people, you know, who curse at the database and eventually at the DB as well. But, you know, I'll talk a bit about myself. I'm just a random guy. Looks exactly like, you know, one of you guys, you know, two eyes, a nose, just any random guy. And I started my career as an Oracle and DB2 DBA. Bit of SQL Server as well. Then I landed up in a job which was here in Singapore with Ashnik, where I started working with PostgreSQL and later on a bit of MongoDB as well. And now I totally love open source. At Ashnik, we do a lot of open source consulting and a lot of open source solutioning as well. So we work on end-to-end solutions which are totally from, you know, built completely on top of an open source stack. That is my Twitter handle. So if you want to tweet about this session, if you liked it, you didn't like it, you want to curse at me, do that publicly on Twitter. You know, so even my employers can take note of that, and you know, other people can also take note of that. Apart from technology, I love cycling. I go around in Singapore on my bicycle, north, south, a bit of west as well. Those are the tracks that I have done so far. Long road biking. I love photography as well. So, only thing which restricts me is money. You know, it's very costly to take pictures because you need to have good lenses and all that. So, and here is why I love PostgreSQL. It is a database which is fully ACID compliant. It has a very vibrant and active community. You know, there is a open user group where people discuss all the new features quite in public, quite openly. Even if there is a new change being pushed out to the code, it is being reviewed by people in open. The algorithm which is being used for sorting is discussed publicly. People criticize, people give their opinion, and it is respected very well. If you want to get help, you can just shoot out an email at the user group thread and someone would look into that. Someone would come back and reply to you. You definitely are gonna get help from the community. And that is one of the reasons why I consider PostgreSQL as a true open source database. And because everything is there in open, you get help from the open source community as well. There are a lot of advanced features which allows it to scale up very well, like multi-versioning concurrency control, where it keeps multiple versions of the data so that you don't run into inconsistency issues. Well, I'll again not get into my, you know, DB issues, and I will not bore you much with those features. It is very developer friendly, and we are going to see 10 reasons why it is so developer friendly. And it is built to be extended. We'll see a couple of reasons why I say that it is built to be extended and why it is, you know, a very extensible database. So when it comes to developers, you're always worried about whether whatever I'm going to develop, is it going to be supported on PostgreSQL or not, or on the backend database or not. So for that matter, you know, all these languages that you see there are inbuilt connectors for them. Plus there are inbuilt connectors for a lot more than these, like we have got Node.js connector, and it is supported on a vast array of platforms as well. So you choose a platform and Postgres would run on that because it is written in C language. So anywhere where you can compile C language, you can run Postgres. It is supported on ARM architecture. So how many of you have seen Raspberry Pi? You can run Postgres on that. It is also ported in Netezza. It can run on Power Platform, RISC architecture. It can run very well on x86 as well. It runs on Ubuntu, on CentOS, Red Hat, Windows, AIX. I know people who are using it on AIX. I know a customer, my own customer, who is running it on AIX. Now I'm going to talk about 10 features why developers should love PostgreSQL. These are those 10 features you will be missing if you are using, you know, any other proprietary database. And when I say proprietary databases, I mean Oracle, DB2, SQL Server, and likes. So it has got JSON features, it has got vast data type supports like money, time, boolean, all these data types which we are going to explore more. You can have foreign data wrappers here. Then you have got user defined operators. We'll see what those are and how it works and how it is helpful. You have got user defined extensions as well, which allows you to do more with your PostgreSQL database, an existing database, where you can add features that you want to have. You can add them via extensions. And we'll see a couple of examples of that as well, how people have done that. You can create filter-based indexes. We'll see what those are. More granular control on your parameters. So there are certain parameters which you can control as a developer. You can set certain parameters within your session. You can control those parameters at user levels as well. And we'll see how those work out. Indexes can be used for gathering statistics in runtime. We'll see. I'll explain a little bit about why statistics are important and why this particular feature is that really helpful to you as a developer. Full text search and bulk upload APIs. So I'll start with one feature at a time, and then I'll elaborate on them. JSON features. So have any of you bought something from Amazon? Have you gone to the Amazon website, Amazon.com, not AWS, Amazon.com, where you go and buy stuff? That is where Amazon started from, right? How many of you have gone to Amazon websites? Not many. Okay. So you still go to the physical shops and buy your stuff, or you have gone to some other online websites as well? Right? So when you go to Amazon website and you look for a phone, the features that you're going to find, on your left-hand side pane, there will be a feature filter, right? Where you will find that screen size, the camera, right? The operating system, whether it is Android or and the brand name, Samsung, LG, Apple, all these filters would be there, right? But when you go and look for, let's say, shoes, you'll find color, you'll find size, probably one of the filters, brand, price range, all these kind of filters. Completely different set of filters, right? So can Amazon or can any e-commerce industry who's trying to sell a vast array of products, can they afford to store all that in a relational database? No. You will end up either having too many fields or too many tables, too many child tables, right? For that, you need something which is flexible. That is where JSON comes in picture. So version 9 of earlier, one of the guys from Postgres community, he talked about, Satoshi, he talked about JSON features, so I'll not elaborate much on that. But you can store JSON documents inside PostgreSQL. Two fields can be completely different. You can store arrays inside one of the fields, and you can create JIN indexes on these fields. And these JIN indexes can be useful for doing searches, for retrieving data from your JSON data stores or your tables. Okay. It also provides you, Postgres also provides you JSON functions and operators. Using these JSON functions and operators, you can write a data access API. So how I look at it is, I can write data access API and store my database or my data in a JSON document format inside my database, as long as my data is not really firmed up, my schema is not firmed up. Once my schema firms up, I'll translate those JSON fields into tables, fixed tables. And still, I'll have my JSON API returning data in JSON format. So there is no impact on my actual application. My application still consumes data in JSON API or in JSON format, right? So that is how I can actually go agile as well. I can keep on adding fields in my JSON document or in my JSON text field as long as I'm having need for new fields. Once I have formed up those fields, I'll translate them into columns, and I'll use JSON APIs to return data.
So question. So you mean there is a temporary format for the data before it's converting to the relational database, right?
Not really. It is actually an actual field that you're storing data. So today I know that I may need. So how it happens in agile development is you start with a functionality, right? You don't know what fields you're going to need. So you keep on adding new fields. But what constrains you down is the need to normalize, the need to have a proper design of your tables, right? That is when you get stuck.
Schema.
Right, a proper fixed schema. So what I'm telling you is, you start with a JSON field. Keep on adding all those data. Once you have got enough amount of data, once you have done enough amount of development, then you can see that these fields are what I'm gonna need. Other fields are not what I'm gonna need. Or these fields could be multi-value attributes. Or these fields are where I'm gonna have normalization requirement. Then normalize them. And since the beginning, return all your data in JSON format using APIs. Once, even if you have made them into proper columns and tables, still continue to return data in JSON format. So user data now sits in proper tables, but still the data returned to application is JSON document, right? So there is no impact on the application, right? So your database could be as agile as your developer. There is vast array of data types which are supported natively, money, interval. So if I want to store like 5 minutes, this top duration is 25 minutes, which I'm running short on. So 25 minutes, if I want to store a duration, I can store that in interval. If I want to store time, this started at 2 p.m., actually 2, 5 p.m. So I can store that in time, data type. So it allows me to store data in the way how my application perceives it. Plus, I can create more data types of my own. I can define my own data types. So as a developer, I have a choice to choose more intuitive types for my data, which is more compatible with my application. So I don't have to do a translation necessarily, right? There are databases who do not support Boolean. So how you actually store data inside your database is you store them as characters, or you store them as integers, 0 or 1, and then in your JDBC API or in your actual program, you do that translation. Oracle doesn't support Boolean for your table data types. DB2 as well, I guess, doesn't support Boolean as a data type for your tables, at least in the versions which I have worked with, which was 11G and 9.7 for DB2. So there is no conversion required here. You know, you store data as you perceive data and as you fetch data, right? Plus, you can define your own data types, and you can define your own indexing methods to deal with those data types. Like you want to store person details as a structure. So you can create your own data type for that. Foreign data wrappers. Now this is something which I love. So, you know, you have a data store which is in MongoDB or which is in Hadoop, and you can access that data store and the entities, rather not the tables, but the entities in those data stores as if they are PostgreSQL tables, right? So you can say select star from some, let's say, customer details, and that would get data from MongoDB, you know, and that MongoDB could be a sharded cluster. Now, why is it beneficial to developers is because you don't have to actually think about, you know, integrating data or replicating data from other data stores and pulling them together. You can choose a database of your own choice. Let's say, for example, in a banking industry, you can have financial transactions which are running into your system every second or every microsecond. Each transaction is getting pushed down into your system. So those data or those records you can push into a MongoDB database because you are also going to do some kind of analysis on that, or into a Hadoop database because you will run some offline jobs on them. But if you want to have a join between those financial transactions and your account data, you can do that in PostgreSQL. And the good part is PostgreSQL can push the filter predicates to these data stores. So if you run a query with a where clause, that where clause will be pushed down to MongoDB. It will not execute in the PostgreSQL layer. It will execute that on MongoDB. And in future releases, with further enhancements in 9.5, it is even going to push aggregates to the underlying data stores. So that is a real advantage which you will have as a developer. You can integrate multiple environments in your system into your program itself. You don't have to depend on VBAs, or you don't have to depend on a data integrator guy who is going to integrate all that data for you. You can build a logical data hub for yourself as a developer. This is another thing I use quite extensively because my job also involves a lot of migrations, a lot of conversions. So you can define an operator of your own choice. So here I'm defining a different meaning for equal to operator. And here I'm telling that it is going to do a varchar equal to integer. So I want to compare varchars to integers or varchars or strings to floats. If I want to do those kind of comparisons, Postgres doesn't do that comparison natively. That is not facilitated by PostgreSQL itself. But the good part is you can write a very simple operator yourself to do that. And then once this operator is created, it is added in the library. Any kind of operation which matches these two data types, it will be performing using the equality operator. That will be performed. This function will be executed. And you can define your own rules there. I can also replace an existing function. So equal to generally does a string match where it is case sensitive. I want to do a case insensitive search on my database. So I can define a function and I can override the existing equality operator. So you can define operators of your own. You can define operators for a data type that you have defined yourself. Okay. It allows you to also do a lot of migration stuff, because I do a lot of migration. So if there is a particular functionality, for example, it is very funny. Every other database, when you talk about any database, all of them use double pipe as concatenation operator, right? With an exception, SQL Server. For some very good or bad reason, Microsoft chose to use plus as the concatenation operator. It always does concatenation that way. Now, if I'm migrating something out of SQL Server to Postgres, or let's say SQL Server to Oracle, I have to change my code every year. With PostgreSQL, I have that flexibility to define an operator plus, which does the concatenation for me. So I don't have to change anything in my code. So as a developer, I have choice of defining my own data types and my own operators for those data types. Plus, I can create new operators for existing data type. User-defined extensions. You can extend the existing functionality by adding your own add-on modules. These add-on modules are, once you have compiled them and added to the database, they work as if it is like a native feature of the database. It is like native PostgreSQL feature. I'll talk about some of the popular extensions. PG Prebomb, which just got added in 9.4. Using this extension, you can preload the data in your buffer. So before you start connecting your application, you can load the data in buffers. So you don't have to face cold reboot issues. Then PG Crypto, using which you can have some encrypted data in your database. So you can store, you can encrypt the data before you are storing, particularly important for banking and financial industry. PG Shard, this extension allows you to create a sharded cluster of Postgres. So you can have a distributed database. Some of your data could be sitting on one node, some of it could be sitting on the second node. And this is by hacking into the actual execution. So how SQLs are executed, that also has been extended in this particular extension. And this is provided by CitusDB. PostGI, sorry, that's a typo. It is PostGIS. PostGIS, it is not GIST, it is GIS. PostGIS allows you to create a complete spatial database inside PostgreSQL. Then you can use, there are other extensions to play around with the internals of Postgres, how buffers are stored, how dead, which rows are dead, all that information. Plus there are more enhanced text search extensions for fuzzy string and trigram matches. You can create partial indexes in PostgreSQL. So, not many times what you do, you don't actually delete data from your application. What you do a soft delete. Just mark that row as deleted. you say N or delete is Y or no more or expired is yes, something like that. You don't actually delete the data because of various regulatory rules and all those things. And whenever you access your data, you always access where is deleted is false or where expired is false, right? So in those cases, these indexes are really helpful because I can create an index on my accounts table where I can say that closed is false. So it is only going to cover these rows where closed is false. It is not going to cover any other row. Plus, I can create smaller indexes on different data sets. So I can say, create an index on accounts table where account type is current, another index where account type is savings. So these indexes are going to be fairly small, and those smaller indexes will perform faster. I can control the parameters at very granular level. So I can control them at database level or at user level. So within the same instance, I can have two different databases, one for reporting and one for OLTP. And I can have different parameters for each of them. I can control them at user level. I can have a user who is going to run batches. And I can have larger sort memory for that user. Or I can set consistency parameters to be low for that user so that I get a performance boost. I can set them in connection or session level. So just before doing a bulk upload, I can set synchronous commit off, so which will give my bulk upload a very boost. Yeah, so this is what I talked about earlier. PostgreSQL can get all these statistics on the fly. So you know why statistics are important? Because these statistics are a way your optimizer decides how to query the data. Like if the data, your table has got 1 million rows, your optimizer will decide that it is not going to do a table scan. But if your table has got 10 rows, it will do a table scan. But let's say you have got a highly volatile table, which grows from 10 rows to 1 million rows within 10 minutes. So statistics are not going to get collected instantly. They are collected offline, or they are collected, once asynchronously rather. Right. So that is where PostgreSQL helps you, because as a developer, you don't really have to, worry about collecting these stats after every bulk upload. So the first thing which comes into my mind as a developer is, if statistics are so important, do I need to do a stats collection after every bulk upload? Not really. You can actually rely on PostgreSQL's optimizer, which is smart enough to do a quick check on the indexes. So I will have some indexes on these tables. These indexes will store some indicative data about my stats as well. And checking the same thing on the table rather than checking on index would be costly. So I'll do a quick check on the indexes to find out how many potential rows are there. And based on that, I'll decide whether to do a table scan or index scan or what join algorithm is to be used. So as a developer, this is something which is internal to the system. As a developer, you may not see this very useful to you or tangible to you, but it is really helpful to you as a developer. It avoids that extra step of doing a stats update in your database. There is a JDBC copy API for PostgreSQL, which allows you to do bulk upload. Copy is a command in Postgres which allows you to copy data from flat files into the database. With JDBC API, you can programmatically do that. So you can write a program which reads a file or which reads inputs from standard input device and loads into the database. It is quite efficient, works better than the insert statements or even the parameterized queries, right? Because it does it more faster way, in a much more faster way. The last thing, which is again quite useful to you as a developer, you can use PostgreSQL's functions operators to write an application which does full text search. So Postgres is capable of facilitating full text search. You can store your data, texture data in PostgreSQL, and you can create gin indexes on that. Gin indexes are much, it is not that gin which you go out and in pubs and drink. It is, I don't really remember the complete abbreviation for that. But they are very helpful in creating indexes on textual data. It doesn't index the whole text, it indexes in a much more smarter way. And then you can use them to search your data, to do pattern searches like regular expression searches, searches which contains, let's say, summary somewhere in the middle of a paragraph. That is where gin indexes are really helpful. It makes your life easier. You don't have to deal with another component which does just full text search. You can do that in the database itself, with the database features itself. You can also do phonex matches or soundex matches like SAM and SAN. They sound quite similar. If you want to do those kind of searches, you have extensions for those. You want to do fuzzy text search, you have extensions for those. You can do trigram matches, you have extensions for those. If you want to explore more about PostgreSQL, there are further blogs from various community developers. George Burgess, Bruce Bomgier, Simon Riggs, Magnus Hangender. And then there is an aggregator, planetpostgres.org, where you can find a lot of blogs being aggregated. So you can go and search for the feature that you're looking for. Other thing which I do quite often is search in the community threads. There are user groups, email lists. You can search through those discussions. A lot of your problems will get solved by just looking at the discussions, because they get solved my problems not many times. Then, of course, the big book of PostgreSQL, the online documentation on PostgreSQL.org, that is always helpful. And if you have got any questions, just give me 2 more minutes if people have got any questions.
What's the license of PostgreSQL?
It is an open source license. It is PostgreSQL license. The license is PostgreSQL. It is pretty much like BSD. It is pretty much like OpenBSD.
So we can use it for the commercial purpose as well, right?
Yes, you can. Plus, if you would like to have support, there are a lot of companies which provide support for PostgreSQL. Enterprise GP Second Quadrant, there are companies based out of Japan as well. Uptime Technologies, he's here. Plus, we also do a lot of support for our end services.
Yeah, I think the license is one of the reasons why the many companies try to build some PostgreSQL derivatives, like data warehouse software or something like that. So, PostgreSQL is a good starting point for companies to create some new products.
Yeah, so,
yeah.
Alright, I'll close if. There are no more questions then.
How do you compare between MongoDB and MongoDB?
You can actually start setting up your system by
it's a thick pad, it's okay.
So MongoDB is built for a completely different purpose, That is where you have to do distributed data. You have to run parallel distributed computing. That is where MongoDB is meaningfully placed. Whereas PostgreSQL is more when you want to have scalability in terms of number of users connecting, number of users writing or reading from your database, and you still want some consistent data. You want asset compliance in your application. You don't want to push that asset compliance thing being built into application. That is where you use PostgreSQL. So they're used for two different purposes. You define your reasons why you want a data store and what you want from your data store, and then you choose one of them.
Thank you.